Alex and Dan had just finished up a killer leg workout. Squats and lunges and hack squats. Their legs were pumped. Waddling to the locker room, Dan announced, "Man, I can't wait to eat. Hey Alex, do you have our post-workout shakes?" Alex was usually the one to bring theirs, but on this fateful day, as Alex began rummaging through his bags, he realized the unthinkable had occurred. He forgot their protein powder. "We gotta go, Dan, now!" A little confused, Dan tried to keep up by rushing to the car. They got in and sped off. Dan had never seen Alex drive this way. What is going on? "Man, if we don't eat within 30 minutes, that whole workout will be a total waste. We won't see any growth, so we need to get some protein in us now." Alex was speaking about something called the anabolic window. The anabolic window is perhaps the most persistent belief when it comes to food timing and muscle growth. But is there any truth to it? Alex sure seemed to think so. Dan wasn't so sure, but he definitely didn't want to be wasting a workout either, so they continued on their way. Changing lanes, zipping through traffic, and possibly breaking a traffic law or two, they made it home just in time. Whoa, that was close. Eating food at certain parts of the day to maximize performance or muscle growth is appropriately known as food timing. On the surface, it seems to make sense. Nutrition is vital for muscle growth, so the time you eat it would probably matter. But when is that time and how much does it matter? Dan and Alex decided they needed to get to the bottom of it so as not to risk their life again for nothing. Well, let's be honest, risking your life for muscle growth is never worth it, but you get the point. What Dan and Alex are going to discover is the easiest hack there is to build muscle, changing the time they eat their food. And yes, there is a specific time that can make a difference. But first, why would it even matter? Well, there are actually a few good reasons why eating your food at different times throughout the day could make a difference. However, not all food is created equal, so they first need to distinguish what foods can make a difference in the first place. Your body has a total of 3 macronutrients: protein, fat, and carbs. These are the 3 nutrients which your body needs a large amount of in order to support basic life functions. All of them are crucial for life, but not all of them play an important role in muscle growth. The most important nutrient you eat which affects muscle growth is definitely protein. Along with positive energy balance and exercise stimulus, consuming adequate protein increases muscle protein synthesis. This is the process that builds new muscle. As protein causes an increase, your body will build more muscle. At the same time, protein is composed of a long string of amino acids. These are the same amino acids which muscle fiber is composed of, so eating protein is actually supplying the building blocks to muscle fiber. While carbs are usually associated with providing energy, they may also play a role in building muscle. One role that carbs may have is they cause an insulin spike upon eating. Insulin causes your body to transport glucose from your blood and store it in your muscles as glycogen. Further, this increase in insulin prevents the breakdown of muscle. This helps to mitigate the breakdown of any muscle for fuel and encourages the use of carbohydrates for fuel. At the same time, there's also reason to believe that eating carbohydrates can help fuel workouts. If a person is able to complete a greater workload, this will transfer into more muscle growth. Well, theoretically. When it comes to fat, while it is essential to a healthy life, it has little to do with muscle growth, especially in the context of food timing. Its main benefit is that it's high energy, so it could be used to provide calories for those who have trouble eating enough. Regardless, Dan and Alex need to primarily pay attention to when to eat protein, and to a lesser extent, carbs. So, is there a best time to eat to increase muscle growth? Dan and Alex hit the books and tried looking for a definitive answer. As it turns out, there's a few, but it all depends on a bunch of factors. As Dan and Alex read through study after study, they realize that there is a ton of nuance to this question. Are you just having one meal a day? Are you eating small meals numerous times a day? What time of day are you working out? Or are you even working out? Putting timing aside for a minute, they were able to define some absolutes concerning their nutrition and muscle growth. First of all, if they wanted to increase their muscle growth, they needed to eat a caloric surplus. They knew this, so it wasn't too much of a surprise. However, even though they knew this, it doesn't mean it wasn't an issue, at least for one of them. Dan never had an issue with eating enough, but Alex did. He was one of the lucky ones who had problems gaining weight. Alex learned that adding high-caloric snacks more frequently throughout the day could make eating an adequate amount of calories easier. Little did Alex know he'd learn a very effective hack later. There is a certain time of the day that he could eat a snack that would help increase his calories, improve recovery, and increase muscle growth. He'll learn that later in the video. The main point is that total calorie intake is essential to muscle growth. At the same time, the food where you get these calories also matters. Mentioned at the beginning of this video, protein is the most important macronutrient that drives muscle growth. Just as total calorie intake matters, so does the total protein intake. This is yet another area that Dan and Alex had some knowledge of. However, they differed on what they thought enough was. Dan used the common intake prescribed to bodybuilders of 1 gram of protein for every pound of body weight. This is a good number to use for most people, but it could vary slightly. However, Alex ate only half of that, 0.5 grams per pound of body weight. So who was right? Dan was. While there is no specific number that's defined by sport researchers, the minimum suggested amount is 0.6 grams per pound of body weight, with the upper limit being around 1.1 grams per pound of body weight. Anywhere between that range would probably be sufficient for those who are in a caloric surplus with the goal of gaining muscle. Now, what Alex and Dan weren't so sure of is if it matters when you eat this protein. In fact, this was what started this whole issue in the first place. As they continued, they would learn there are, in fact, certain times to consume protein to maximize muscle growth. But let's look at carbs first. Concerning carbs, while they play more of an indirect role, there is one overarching guideline they learned they needed to follow. Eat enough. This was very important for Dan as he happened to be currently following a low-carb diet. However, by limiting his carb intake, Dan was limiting the extent that he would see muscle growth. Many studies have shown that low-carb diets are suboptimal when muscle growth is the primary objective. Interestingly, low-carb diets may be effective at preserving muscle mass while in a cutting phase. However, as they were both wanting to gain muscle, Dan needed to increase his carb intake before he even started to think about food timing. Putting the actual timing to the side, they concluded that the most important thing they needed to do with their nutrition was meet these requirements. Again, there are three primary guidelines. Eat a 300 to 500 caloric surplus daily, consume 0.6 to 1.1 grams of protein per pound of body weight, and consume an adequate amount of carbs, which equals at least 30% of your total calories consumed. They both needed to fix these areas and spent some time learning how to hit the proper amount of their macros and calories. If they continued eating an inadequate amount of calories or protein, it wouldn't really matter when they ate as they weren't providing the nutrition it needed. Once they made the necessary alterations to their overall diet, now they were in a better position to start worrying about food timing. Since Dan and Alex were eating an appropriate amount of calories and protein now, did that mean it didn't really matter when they ate? Not exactly. There are usually two sides on this issue, both extreme and both wrong. On one side, there are those who provide food timing way too much concern, almost to the point that it's all that matters. On the other side are those that say it doesn't matter when you eat. Dan and Alex were now going to wade through the nuance and find their answer. As this whole discussion started because of the anabolic window, they decided that was the best place to start. In fact, this is by far the most popular and well-known nutrition hack in bodybuilding. Unfortunately, it's not true at all. Actually, that's not true either. There is some truth to it. Again, the anabolic window is a 30-minute window that occurs immediately after you finish a workout. During this time, your body is primed for growth. Just as consuming protein increases muscle protein synthesis, so does resistance training. Therefore, you should consume a meal with protein and carbohydrates in order to take advantage of this rise as well as prevent any muscle breakdown. Nothing entirely wrong with this. So far, so good. What the anabolic window gets wrong is it would have you believe that if you miss this window, you have basically ruined your entire training session. Even worse, you may even lose muscle. This is a highly exaggerated explanation of what is actually going on. When you eat a meal containing high protein and carbs, amino acids will still be available for a few hours, as well as glycogen from your carb intake. Therefore, if you eat a meal a few hours before a workout, your body will still have the nutrients available, so eating immediately after loses its importance. Further, the increase in muscle protein synthesis continues longer than 30 minutes. For example, a study examined the effect that protein would have when eaten an hour after training and 3 hours after training. They found that a rise in muscle protein synthesis was similar, suggesting that there's literally no difference. With that said, this doesn't mean you should wait hours and hours after your training session just because. You should still have a meal sooner than later. However, if you forgot to bring your protein to the gym, there's no reason you need to speed home like Alex and Dan did. With that said, what if you haven't eaten before your workout? It just so happened that Alex was going to train early the next morning and was thinking of just training fasted. Training fasted is a relatively common practice, especially for those who train early in the morning. Any of you in the 5 a.m. crew, 6 a.m. If you've never heard of fasted training, it's simply when you train after a prolonged period of not eating. This generally occurs when a trainee trains first thing in the morning before breakfast. As training fasted means you are depleted of nutrition, now the anabolic window has a little bit more significance. Remember that the reason the anabolic window isn't important under normal conditions is because it assumes you're training after you have eaten. The problem is if you train fasted, your body is already heavily depleted of glycogen as well as amino acids. If Alex were to do heavy resistance training in this state, his body would not have the nutrients it needs to mitigate muscle breakdown and promote muscle growth. This means that if you train fasted, now the anabolic window has a little bit more validity. So this actually gives us two guidelines. The first is to have a serving of carbs and protein before your workout. In addition to mitigating the chance of muscle breakdown, this could also provide more fuel for a better workout. However, if you train fasted, you should eat directly after you finish your workout. When compared with not eating, this could result in greater muscle gains. Dan and Alex now understand that your meal before or after training can impact their overall muscle growth. Now, what about times other than around their training time? Before and after are taken care of, but what about during? Intra-workout nutrition is a practice used by many, including Dan and Alex, every once in a while. Does it hold any validity? As Dan and Alex learned, there's nuance. There's always nuance. If Dan and Alex are consuming an adequate amount of protein and carbs throughout the day, consuming nutrients during the workout probably isn't going to make much of a difference. Probably. But there are some situations where it could. Dan and Alex usually train for about 60 minutes a workout. Under these conditions, supplying the body with nutrients during the workout probably won't be necessary, as glycogen levels are full from their carb intake in their previous meal, and there are plenty of amino acids to be used as well. However, sometimes they like to push their training. Sometimes they will follow some programs that can go on for up to 90 minutes to push their bodies to the limit. This prolonged time can deplete glycogen levels to a point where the body needs to turn to amino acids for fuel. In addition, there is less glycogen to supply energy, causing a decrease in their workload. Less work means less muscle growth. Therefore, during their longer workouts, they decided that they should add some intra-workout nutrition just to be sure. This is a scenario in which amino acids would work well, as they're easy to consume and taste great. They made a drink that is 6% carbs and has around 10 grams of amino acids to sip on during their workout. This could also be beneficial for when they are going to train in a fasted state. Dan and Alex now know what they need to consume around the time of their workout. What about other times? Assuming they're consuming enough total calories and macronutrients, the answer is yes. There actually is a specific time of day for consuming food to increase muscle mass, even when eating sufficient amounts of calories and protein. There's something very unique about this time that has been overlooked by so many for so long. We'll get to that later, but there's also another important variable to consider with food timing. However, it's not so much when to eat, but how often to eat. As mentioned in the beginning of the video, eating protein causes an increase in muscle protein synthesis. However, as the body absorbs and utilizes the amino acids, this rise will eventually taper off. It will remain low until the next protein-rich meal, which will then cause another spike. Dan and Alex decided to try something. Would it make much of a difference if they ate all of their food in one meal, or if they ate a bunch of smaller meals throughout the day? So Dan decided that he would eat all of his protein in one sitting in the morning. This was a lot of protein, but Dan figured perhaps if he ate it all at once, it would cause a massive spike in muscle protein synthesis and continue through the day, right? On the contrary, Alex decided that he would try spacing his protein out throughout the day. He split his total protein intake into 5 meals and ate them every 4 hours or so. When Dan ate all of his protein at once, he was right that it would cause a larger rise in protein. However, he was wrong about it lasting all day. To make matters worse, Dan learned that there was a threshold. Eating protein will only provide benefits up to a certain extent. On the other hand, while Dan's smaller feedings didn't cause as high of a spike in muscle protein synthesis, it still caused a significant rise. These rises would continue about 3 to 5 hours, so as they were getting low, he would already be eating another serving of protein, which increased the rate again. This went on for all 5 meals, which resulted in a continuous increase in muscle protein synthesis. Sports researchers have observed this same phenomena. Assuming each meal contains enough protein, above 20 grams, more frequent meals seem to offer benefits to muscle growth when compared to just a couple big meals. So while not necessarily a specific time of the day, Dan decided to follow Alex and split up his protein intake across the day. It's an easy fix, and if it gets him more gains, he's down. As of now, Dan and Alex have figured out that their total calories, protein intake, and carbohydrate intake are most important. They've also figured out what they need to do during the time around their workout. Further, they are also spreading their protein intake throughout the day. Anything else? Yes, there is. As Alex and Dan were getting ready for bed, they were thinking about what they had learned. It seems the primary role that nutrition timing has in increasing muscle growth is it increases muscle protein synthesis. They then began to think about their previous meal, which was an hour or so ago. Man, we're not going to eat again for another 8 to 10 hours, they thought. Too bad they couldn't eat protein during that time. But wait, why couldn't they? Of course they could. This is something they had never even thought of. They could eat some protein just before they go to bed to supply amino acids while they sleep. Would that work? They were onto something and weren't the only people to think about that. In fact, many sport researchers have pondered this, and pre-sleep protein is actually one of the most exciting areas of research in sports nutrition currently. Many studies have been conducted in this area, and most come back with positive results. For example, a study from 2021 found that 30 to 40 grams of protein taken 30 minutes before sleep resulted in higher levels of muscle protein synthesis throughout the night, which could result in more muscle growth. Now, there is one caveat: you should consume casein protein. Unlike the more popular whey protein, which is a fast-acting protein, casein protein is a slow-digesting protein. This means it takes a longer time to break down, which results in a rise of muscle protein synthesis that is not as high as whey's. However, as it takes longer to break down, this rise lasts longer. This is perfect for sleep, as you won't be eating for a long period. Dan and Alex thought that didn't sound too bad. Simply eat more protein before bedtime and get better recovery. Further, this made it easier to get in more protein if needed, as well as a few more calories. Ultimately, they learned that speeding home to get their post-protein shake was pretty silly. They also learned that while there are some times of the day that eating could benefit muscle growth, it doesn't matter if their diet is out of whack. Therefore, if you're still struggling on hitting your macros and calories on a consistent basis, that's where the majority of your effort should be placed. Fix that and then worry about timing. Once you get your nutrition under control, then you can put effort into tweaking your timing to maximize any potential. Again, here's a quick review of when to eat to maximize your growth. 1. Spread your protein intake into 4 to 5 equal servings and spread them out across the day. Each serving should be at least 20 grams of protein. 2. If you train fasted, eat a meal of carbohydrates and protein within 30 minutes after training. You may also benefit from eating a larger amount of protein, up to 40 grams. 3. If you train after you eat, a post-workout meal is not as important, but eat sooner than later if possible. You may also benefit from eating a larger amount of protein, up to 40 grams. 4. If you're training for durations longer than 70 minutes or training twice a day, consuming an intra-workout drink containing 6% carbohydrates and around 10 grams of amino acids can minimize any breakdown of muscle and help maintain higher muscle protein synthesis. 5. Consume 30 to 40 grams of casein protein 30 minutes before sleep.